invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning, everyone. Thank you all for honoring our invitation. I'm truly honored to be hosting this special event with my friend, His Excellency Ambassador Lang Yehu, Permanent Mission of the Gambia Mission to the United Nations. I'm deeply grateful to have organized this event with our collective members, including Dr. Unegbe Yeong of our collective future group, Mr. Mark of TUC Corporation, Sean of the Wall Street News Agency, and many other partners that are here. The obvious question is, what is the purpose of this summit? The very reason that we are all gathered here. You see, poverty and seeking solutions for eradicating poverty and climate change are important issues and topics. Poverty, as we all have seen, is a never-ending vicious cycle of human exploitation, corruption and abuses. Ultimately, to break this cycle, the greed of humans must be taken out of the solution, or at least supervised by moral law in the system. So recently, the United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres made the statement that the United Nations must embrace blockchain technologies. And so today, at the summit, we want to learn how we can actually use blockchain technology and artificial intelligence to help in the eradication of poverty and other sustainable goals. The sustainable goals, so they were really focusing on two main sustainable development goals. The sustainable development goal number one, which is no poverty, and sustainable development goal number 13, which is climate action. These are of utmost importance because without attaining these goals, women really contribute to fully attain sustainable development that we're all working at to achieve. So we hereby today want to learn from others who are using artificial intelligence and blockchain technologies to make progress towards the eradication of poverty and climate change. Like many of you here today, I am not a blockchain expert, but I am an advocate seeking for eradication of poverty, for solutions to eradicating poverty, climate change, and all the other sustainable goals. So we will have a welcome remarks from our main host, our chair for this occasion, His Excellency Ambassador Lang Yehu, to officially make his remarks to open and declare the summit, to give a welcoming remark and declare the summit open. We will also have an opportunity to hear from our collective members and our organizing teams and experts as they share their insightful solutions on this topic. We'll have three main subjects: technology, commercial, and the humanity. Covering the technology space on the subject of artificial intelligence and blockchain will be Nicholas and Andrew. We'll also have Sean and Daryl, who will share their work on the adult, using blockchain and artificial intelligence. So after the welcome address by His Excellency Ambassador, we will be hearing from our beautiful moderator, who will Angie, the beautiful computer, who will be completing the final discussion. So, at this time, without much ado, I will give the time for the other to give us his welcome remarks. Thank you for being so helpful. Thank you for coming once again. Let's sit back and let's learn together, rub our minds together, like we say in Africa, and ways.
Everyone, I will start by acknowledging the presence of the following people. My friend Dr. Queen Blessing, who was founder Global Empowerment Movement USA. Representatives of World Trade News Agency, our collective, GUC Incorporated, my colleagues from the Permanent Mission of Gambia, diplomats, invited delegates. I am honored to be the host of this important event, geared towards looking at ways of combating poverty and climate change with the use of artificial intelligence. On behalf of my colleagues at the Permanent Mission of the Gambia in New York, I seek this opportunity to extend special thanks and appreciation to Dr. Queen Blessing Kutua and her team, all other partners and attendees, for enabling the realization of today's event. Could you recall that the SDGs were adopted by the international community to create a sustainable future for humankind by ensuring economic growth, social inclusion, and environmental protection? For those of us from the developing South, the payment of the 17 SDGs, especially SDG 1 and SDG 13, the theme for today's event, is a matter of urgency. This is because the menace of poverty, climate change continues to be among the greatest threats to our peace and security, social cohesion, and development. Therefore, addressing these challenges is not a choice, but a must, because without that, the hope of attaining the other SDGs will remain a mere dream for the world. Therefore, I believe I can speak for all of you when I say that SDG 1, no poverty, is a crisis that all want to join hands and combat as soon as possible. It's a crisis that has a domino effect of factors that include human exploitation, corruption, and abuse. This is where artificial intelligence blockchains comes in by using different technological mechanisms to process economic development and provide equal sustainable exploitation for all. Consequently, time has come for humanity to continue engaging in critical thinking to ensure the use of all innovative ways to free the world of poverty and the dangers of climate change. I suddenly cannot do business as usual. This is because this is the last decade for the world to attain the SDGs. The organization of this gathering is in that spirit, and it is expected that the interventions of the knowledgeable panel of experts will help us a lot in providing better understanding as to how mankind can effectively utilize artificial intelligence blockchain to combat two of the greatest threats for mankind, i.e. poverty and climate change. As we enter the crucial decade of action and the attainment of the SDGs, we must find different new, sustainable and innovative ways of confronting poverty and climate change. This is the opportunity offered by the use of AI blockchain technologies, and hence the importance. The use of AI blockchain technologies can provide humanity with the capacity needed to collect, analyze, and store relevant scientific data related to poverty and climate change. Its fundamental technological building blocks are utilized in any application that processes and stores data, which in today's modern age, it can be a valuable tool in almost everything, including healthcare management, transportation logistics, finance and platforms, just to name a few. The AI blockchain, in addition to the above, also avail mankind with the needed tool for sustainable supervision and measuring of development indicators promote and facilitate accountability for both the citizens and the pension workers. It is a known fact that recent advancements in robotics and supercomputers have provided a platform for new AI cognitive machines are beginning to emerge from the domain of science fiction in the scientific reality. Since the development of blockchain in 2008, it has become a very important vital ladder tool for information management. Although we are still in the early stages of potentially implementing these technologies into achieving the SDGs, it is encouraging to see there are already plenty of innovators working to use the technology to address the current challenges facing humanity. Collaborative efforts will hopefully serve to help us with the needed solutions. However, it is also important to point out that in our collective drive for innovation, mankind must always adhere to all ethical precautions to avoid potential backlash of people to its innovation. Staying human in the age of innovation, finding the right balance in our actions becomes crucial. There is also the issue of ensuring fair and equitable sharing of the benefits of new innovations globally. In conclusion, I remain convinced that in occasions like today, humankind will certainly continue to endeavor to remain on the course for the eradication of poverty and the challenges of climate change for the benefit of humanity. These remarks I have a single on.
Thank you, Dr. Queen Blessing. Thank you, Ambassador. I'm very honored to be here. I'm Andrew from Wall Street News Agency. Now it's my honor to introduce the panel representation members. Nicholas Hardy. Nicholas Hardy, I'm spending several years in financing and overseas real estate investment. He had the good fortune of meeting Mr. Wang Yingjin, founder of GUC. Together, they realized that they share a vision of the world where blockchain technology will create an even economic playing field. For his work with Chinese immigrant communities here in New York, he has been awarded a citation of honor from the Queen Borough President. Let's welcome Nicholas Hardy.
Identity crisis.
Just last week, I read an article on World Economic Forum, in which a writer began by correctly differentiating between blockchain, cryptocurrency, digital currency, but then proceeded to say that for the sake of brevity, those three concepts would be used interchangeably for the rest of the article. It is sleights of hand like this, both innocent and purposeful, that have brought us to a very formal role. Will blockchain technology be used for good, to support the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, or will it become just another tool to create wealth for the sake of creating wealth? On the one hand, advocates of blockchain and cryptocurrency call its potential to bring banking and financial services to 1.7 billion people around the world who are either underbankable or completely unbankable. But on the other hand, blockchain simply is not as open and democratic as many of its advocates would ever believe. While the code for Bitcoin, for example, may be open source, the actual exchanges and mechanisms for its practical use are not. The same is arguably true for all forms of blockchain. So 30 years ago, when Tim Berners-Lee invented the World Wide Web, his hope was that technology would foster collaboration and participation in the synthesis and dissemination of information worldwide. But within 10 years of his advent, Berners-Lee already saw reason to invent, though his vision had been co-opted. The World Wide Web became the consumer publishing movement that focused on pushing information to consumers rather than empowering collaborators. Perhaps the same could be said of blockchain technology today. How collaborative and accessible is it really? There's no shortage of speculation as to how blockchain technology can be used for things like supply chain management, insurance contracts, wills and inheritances, tracking the provenance of food, protecting the integrity of elections, real estate, intellectual property, so much more. But I do not see how any of these applications are really addressing the big issues like poverty and climate change that are facing us today. To me, they sound more like corporate objectives. Make no mistake, we are at a crossroads, and there is a very real danger that people will fall into a slumber of believing that many proselytizers of blockchain technology say that it is a panacea, that it will eliminate corruption and remove the human element of error from our transactions. But I'm not so convinced. I'm wary of technology that purports to make up for or render inconsequential the shortcomings of mankind. It's just too easy of an out. It removes too much individual accountability, which is ironic because one of the apparent objectives of blockchain has been decentralized before. But if authority is decentralized, it doesn't just disappear. Somebody has to pick up the slack. If we are to address poverty and climate change, I think we have to recognize that we are in an ongoing fight. That the fight against them is not the one and done, but that it will be eradicated by 2030 and never show their faces again. We are all responsible. We must all commit to achieving the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals by making conscientious choices about the technologies we use. That being said, technology alone cannot eliminate poverty. It can, however, facilitate the global exchange of ideas, information, and capital from, say, the farmer in Wisconsin, or China, with an entrepreneur in Gambia. That is the sort of collaboration that Berners-Lee had envisioned for the World Wide Web, and that is the sort of commerce that blockchain technology can help facilitate. So long as we're talking about more than just cryptocurrencies, remember, we're not here today to talk about Bitcoin. We're here to talk about blockchain, which in the simplest terms I can put it, is simply a growing list of records that we call blocks, linked together using cryptography into an unbroken chain. That's the name, blockchain.
Another way of looking at it is that blockchain is a decentralized distributed ledger that records transactions across the network so that records cannot be altered retroactively without altering all subsequent records. The advantage of this whole setup is that a designed blockchain is resistant to modification of its data. I emphasize the word resistant because blockchain technology, like all technology, is not perfect. But I think that part of the message often gets lost in all the enthusiasm. While everyone is busy singing its praises and thinking of new applications for it, deep down, blockchain is basically just a means to facilitate transactions between people who do not know each other or trust each other. But is that really such a good thing? Call me old-fashioned, but I have no faith in a world without trust. The true value of blockchain will lie in creating an environment conducive to the free flow and exchange of ideas and capital. Not by creating silos where we isolate ourselves and sit in place behind walls of code. Instead, we build technologies that foster trust and collaboration across borders, that wealth will follow shortly behind. And once people have attained the level of wealth where they can be free to pursue other endeavors, beyond just meeting the minimum requirements provided for the physical needs, then we can all become stewards of this planet and address the other issues of our times, like climate change. This, at least, is part of the vision that you see. And there's a vision of the mission of all of you. Thank you.
Senior advisor from YesCoin, and as a moderator also mentioned, so I have a more than 20 years IT and management experience in Wall Street, and also a unified system for New York State Supreme Court, and also a nonprofit organization and innovative power corporation. I used to work for a network infrastructure operation manager in the largest clearing house and settlement house in Wall Street. I also was an associate network administrator in the New York Supreme Court. And also I work as an MIS associate director in a nonprofit organization. The organization is helping the people who are suffering economic uncertainty and also suffering domestic violence problems and also illness and also have a problem regarding to the food. So, and also I'm an active green energy consultant and real estate investor, developer, and also green rental properties. So now, before we go deeper to the agenda, let me ask a question for everybody. So what's the definition of a property in terms of how much dollar a person is making per day? Hopefully anybody can answer this question. It's like therapy. Mm-hmm. Boom, 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 boom. Anybody? Anybody? Yes? That's a wonderful good answer. Who else?
I grew with it by
That's another good answer. I'm so surprised, a young gentleman. Thank you for you, but understand this question. Thank you. This is why we want to involve the youth, women. And yes, yes. Global. That's another perfect answer. Thank you. All right. So what's the UN definition? Because again, this is a UN definition of the whole world. So let me speak for the UN definition. There's 17 of them. So today we're talking about two. The first one is SDG, or Sustainable Development Goal, number one. No properties. There's 736 million to 1.3 billion people living in some forms of properties, making less than $1.25 a day. That would be in the range of all three of answers, right? Thank you, it's a good answer. So by 2030, reduce the number of properties by half and implement social protection system, promote equal rights to basic service, including financial service, allocate enough resource to develop, creating policy and framework to facilitate collaboration at nation and regional level. So this is the UN, one of the UN goals. This is the one that adopted the agenda, and we're going to work with other organizations to provide solution and fight for it. So another agenda at the UN SDG 13 is the climate action. So burning large amount of fossil fuels are after weather patterns that are direct and indirectly impact our food production, and also the sea level rising 1 to 4 feet by 2100. By 2030, strengthen capacity to respond to a nature disaster, integrated planning and national policies, promote awareness, committed to $100 billion annual green funding. Again, $100 billion annual green funding, and increase capacity of women, youth, the gentlemen, I was surprised that some of you, and local community. So this is the one of the SDGs and, from UN. So as you see, UN has a very, very goal, a big goal. I was told by 2021, this $100 billion annual green funding will be available, but I don't get my word on this, market from UN. All right, so we talk about SDG, we talk about the AI and blockchain. So how YesCoin is going to help and provide and work with other associates to provide a solution to fight for these two agendas. So let me introduce five technologies. YesCoin is in race right now. So first one, we're using hybrid mode. So as we heard the gentleman earlier mentioned, blockchain has one of the major characters, decentralized. As we were aware, majority of the financial system or government or market system So what's the difference between centralized and decentralized system? So centralized is a simple word, so controlled by a single entity. Decentralized is no single one entity controlling the entity. So by using this technology, we're going to provide security and performance in terms of speed to bridge the new world adoption, wealth, and distribution. So that meaning that everybody who will participate in the investment in terms of financials. So second technology, as you see on the slide, is biometric ID. It's a digital identity right. You can access to the financial service, reduce the fraud. As everybody is using, I believe right now, fingerprint is one of them. Facial recognition, I believe in a lot of countries, or including these countries, or patients especially, are fully utilize this kind of technology. And voice recognition technology, I know everybody is using my phone, like a lot of like lights and music, and using the voice recognition to operate those tools and devices. This is a second technology our company is offering to help provide a solution. And third is a KYC AML compliance. We're compliance ready. We are going to cooperate with government, NGO, or non-government organization, private sector, to provide the KYC or Know Your Customer or AML, anti-money laundering. I believe a lot of big corporations, financial especially, and governments, every employees, they require to take the course and test after that in order to continue your employment. So this is another technology. And the next slide, the next technology is mobile blockchains. As we already heard the gentleman mention, there are 7 billion mobile phones right now currently in the whole world. So that means the collaboration of the whole world. So it involves more and more people in the whole world to enable them to fight for these two agendas, the poverty as well as the climate action. The last one, the least one, is the smart AI. So as everybody remember, not long ago, one of the companies invented the AlphaGo. It's a very artificial intelligent robot or machine, compete with their chess world champion. He beat them. So this is the kind of technology, AI, artificial intelligence, we're going to use. But not at the same level, but we will improve. So we mentioned about 7 billion phones in the whole world. So I believe, including myself, we know a lot of people using type of cell phones in the US. A lot of people also understand there's a European and Asian, a lot of phones also. And you ask a second question, just for fun. How many of you know how many mobile phones are Google users ever? Just a quick question. Not a general question. Anybody? A young gentleman? Anybody? Just a guess.
35 million.
Anybody else?
Yeah,
oh, no, you're not. You cannot. Yes, the gentleman over there.
100 million.
100 billion is another answer. 2 billion.
200
billion. All right. No more? All right. Let's find our answer. So now the answer. According to the statistics in October 2018, there are 444 million mobile subscribers in Africa. Almost a half billion people. So nobody is getting close. So this is the problem. So mobile, we can embrace the blockchain technology, AI technology, the mobile, blockchain technology that can transform each mobile users to an investor and a mobile capitalist. So that will combating the property, because why is a property? That is a property, the reason become property, there's three major reasons, because of lack of education. People job or find a better job. And third, they don't have the lack of the opportunity to access to the financial system or financial funding. So even they don't have money, they don't have education, they don't have job. So by providing a form, people can learn, people can invest, people can make a form as a bank, as a financial provider. A big one we don't talk about right now, but it's an opportunity to generate money in the form itself, can make a form as a bank, can make a form as a learning machine, a school, and also can make a form as a voting machine to support the climate as a result. So, YesCoin, we provide a YesCoin Academy, so we can be one of the mentioned earlier, why people force education. So lack of education has become a problem. So we're providing the YesCoin Academy, there's multiple channels of education, thousands of people on blockchain, latest technology programs are over there. So we're going to store more and more related, the latest and greatest technology, so that everybody, not only the U.S., but also the world, even the poorest country in the world, can learn, can educate, and educate, and can be financially ready. So we have, right now, we have a very good campaign or program fighting for the climate action. We call Go Green with a YesCoin campaign. So what do we do? So the members will help promote awareness by submitting the photo of how they can contribute to the climate action. So the blockchain, you can be very complicated, it's a high tech, but you can translate it and make it very simple, everybody can use normally. So what we did was high school students in Nigeria, they go to shopping, instead of using the nylon of plastic bag, they're using a tote bag for the grocery shopping. So of course it's a recycled bag, they can use and use again and again and again. So this is one of the good examples, the small examples, we make things simple, but we're using AI and blockchain technology in the background. Everybody engaged and involved in the whole world, no matter where you are, how good you are, how high of education you are. So currently, YesCoin, they have users or have investors, or they have people who own coins in more than 104 countries. I'm not sure you can see the map. So countries we have a different color if it's involved. Account number. Specifically, there are 150,000 YES token holders right now in the world, and 400 of them in 104 countries have been KYC verified and have established their digital identity, which allow them to access financial, not only the financial service, but also the education system and job opportunities. So, what's the KYC again? Only customer and AML also. So to make it short, so I know a lot of people will have a lot of questions in terms of all the topics. Again, no one solution, no one person can solve the whole world, but we're working with all the organizations on the podiums and also every time we involve everybody, we make the complicated things simple, make it happen. In the background, we provide the technology, AI, and blockchain to support this and make it easier, make it more powerful, make it faster, make it more secure. All right. So I have the social media address. If you're interested, feel free to look at it, and also including the email address. And feel free if you have any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you very much. Now, I cannot wait to introduce this amazing woman to both of us. She is the founder of Global Empowerment Movement, GEM. organization with United Nations Economic and Social Council status since 2018. Through this organization, she actively advocates and participates at UN forums to address critical local and global issues for sustainable development. She is a recipient of the Prize in Lifetime Achievement Award, presented by the 44th President of the United States, President Barack Obama, for excellence in service. She is Georgia State Global Nuclear Ambassador and United Nations Representative, dedicated to empowerment services and advocacy to advance family and community development, address public health issues, including gender equality, human trafficking, and routine eradication. She is the author of the Georgia Center Resolution 381, an empowerment book called We Are the Blessing of Africa, reshaping our greatness together. She founded Blessing of Africa, Empowerment Foundation, to focus on addressing issues in Africa. Her mission is to live to her name and to be a blessing to the leading people, especially women prone to subjugation, with special focus on the abused, abandoned single mothers and their children, disadvantaged by food. Ladies and gentlemen, now let's have Dog Queen Blessing.
Development Group is to eradicate this group.
against poverty is further embedded in the United Nations 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which are the blueprint to achieving a better and sustainable future for all. These goals address the global challenges that we all must face, including fight against poverty, inequality, climate change, environmental degradation, peace and justice. Poverty is driven by money, or more correctly stated, the lack of money. It is claimed that 82% of the global wealth is owned by just 1% of the people. Such wealth is centralized and strictly manipulated with distribution of wealth from the rich developed nations to the poor underdeveloped world, typically through unsustainable holdings and loans that makes poorer indebted nations even more poorer and even more indebted. To break this vicious cycle of manipulated poverty, a globalized, decentralized financial instrument is needed. And blockchain, as I've learned, and I keep learning, offers an technological path, such a decentralized open system that balances the financial playing field for all, allowing poorer nations to more efficiently and cost-effectively trade their own natural resources using a universal digital coin, a little token that was no single controlling, that has no single controlling. Okay, to break this vicious cycle of manipulated poverty, a global decentralized financial instrument is needed. And blockchain offers a technological path, such as decentralized open system that balances the financial playing field for all, allowing poorer nations to more efficiently and cost effectively trade their own natural resources using a universal digital token that has no single controlling and manipulating master. The easier access to money without borders will have a trickle down beneficial effect to redistribute wealth to the poor. Of course, simply giving out money without planning will be prone to waste and corruption. So the natural network supervision of digital currencies by a global audit means records of trade transactions publicly scrutinized and approved. It's estimated that corruption reduces the nation's gross domestic product by 4%. A less corruptible system invariably leads to a higher productivity and greater reduction in poverty. Although the vast majority of scientists agree that human activities are contributing factors to global warming, there are opponents that challenge such assessments. And even a few deniers that provide enough data ammunition to political and commercial parties that have vested interest to model the truth for their own electoral campaigns and motivated profits. Like predicting the weather, the science behind analyzing vast quantities of data is complex. Creating enough possibilities to allow for the spread of misinformation and conflicting arguments. A 2013 assessment of over 20,000 published scientific papers since 1990 indicates that 97% concludes that global warming is caused by humans. Despite this overwhelming consensus, I will skip it now. Opponents of climate change usually cite the fact that our planet has naturally enduring periodic cycles of ice, ages, and global warming before men even learned how to use fire, or even that high level of atmospheric carbon dioxide is good for trees. Scientists may find such arguments as oversimplification and distortion of facts, but for the majority of average non-technical people, these simplistic statements are easy to digest, and in many cases, there's sufficient doubts for the minds to take the reality of climate change seriously. As Mark Twain famously quoted, there are lies, damned lies, and then there are some statistics. Although this quote may be considered numerous, the consequence of having statistical data is analyzed and how meaningful conclusions can be drawn from them are very serious matters. In the case of climate change studies, the impact of making the wrong decisions may well determine the future survival of humanity. The amount of data collected on climate change studies are vast, and the modeling used to interpret the data are highly complex. To date, most climate scientists tend to work on their own research in academic isolation or small collaborative group, develop their own algorithms to manipulate their collected data and draw their own conclusions, which even for unsupposedly unbiased scientists, there are invariably personal biases that goes into their research findings, and most importantly, in how they propose solutions. Blockchain is specifically a digital ledger that correlates, manipulates, and stores vast amounts of continuous incoming data. Hence, it is ideally suited as a potential global depository for all climate research data. Artificial intelligence, by its very nature, is a self-learning automated system that advances its knowledge base with which subsequent interactions, and therefore is also ideally suited as an unbiased analyzer of climate data that can find accurate climate change predictions and provide real practical solutions. Google spent $500 million in 2014 to purchase artificial intelligence AI development company DeepMind, which is used mainly for playing